You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Indian security forces continue elimination of Pak-backed terrorists in Kashmir. Pakistan's covert support for Taliban continues unabated. And US tells Pakistan to swiftly complete 27-point action plan on terror. Islamabad's all efforts to revive militancy in Kashmir is failing miserably as Indian security forces are proactively eliminating the terror group commanders along with their recruits, breaking the backbone of Pakistan-sponsored terrorism in Kashmir. Recently, four terrorists, including two top commanders of proscribed terror outfit Lashkar-e-Taiba, were neutralized in Jammu and Kashmir. A report.
Hours of relentless exchange of bullets killed two terrorists, including the top commander of Pakistan-based terror outfit Lashkar-e-Taiba, in Sopore region of Jammu and Kashmir. One of the slain terrorists was identified as Lashkar-e-Taiba commander Fayyaz War, who was responsible for the killing of several innocent civilians and security forces personnel. Earlier in another encounter, security forces neutralized two more LET terrorists, including one regional commander identified as Ishfaq Dar alias Abu Akram, who was active in the valley since 2017. The encounter had started after a joint team of Jammu and Kashmir police and security forces launched a search operation on the basis of specific information about the presence of terrorists in the area. The forces also recovered incriminating materials, including arms and ammunition, from the encounter site.
कल दोपहर में एसएसपी सोपियन को इन्फॉर्मेशन मिला था कि लश्कर-ए-तैयबा का दो तीन मिलिटेंट छिपे हुए हैं उसके बाद पुलिस आर्मी सीआरपीएफ ने कॉर्डन डाला कॉर्डन डालते ही अंदर से ग्रेनेड थ्रो किया मिलिटेंट ने जिसमें आर्मी के एक जवान माइनर इंजरी हुए उसके बाद इनकाउंटर चलता रहा जिसमें देर रात में दो टेररिस्ट मारे गए जिसमें इस बार का हमारा डर है जो लश्कर-ए-तैयबा का पुराना कमांडर है हम सब जानते हैं कि दिसंबर 2018 में जनपुरा इलाका में पुलिस पिकेट पर अटैक किया था जिसमें चार हमारे पुलिस वाले शहीद हो गए थे उनके चारों का रेफर भी लेके चला गया था लोग इसके साथ बहुत सारे ट्रक ड्राइवर को मारा एसपीओ को सिविलियन के लिए इन्वॉल्व था
इन अ बिड टू क्रिएट अनरेस्ट इन द कश्मीर वैली पाक बैक टेरर ग्रुप्स हैव बीन मॉडिफाइंग देयर टेरर टैक्टिक्स इंक्लूडिंग द यूज ऑफ मॉडर्न टेक्नोलॉजी लाइक इंटरनेट to specifically target and execute several prominent personalities of Kashmir. However, security forces claim to have achieved a major breakthrough as they busted a white-collar militant syndicate that would threaten and prepare a strategic hit list of political leaders, government officials, social activists and journalists, thereby identifying targets for various terrorist groups. Five people were running a block site, kashmirfight.wordpress.com, where in the name of the victim was first published, he was profiled giving detailed justification as to how and why he is a legitimate target for the terrorists and subsequently his actual execution by the terror groups. According to forces, with the arrest of the kingpins and the discovery of a huge number of digital devices and the analysis of the data therein, it is expected that the ultimate plans behind the several high-profile killings in the valley.
Pakistan refuses to give up on its evil designs as far as the Kashmir Valley is concerned. Its continuous efforts at infiltration are being foiled by the Indian security forces. Terrorism within the valley is reduced by 33%. It is desperate and wants to create mega chaos and mayhem in the valley. Since it is not succeeding as far as terrorism is concerned, it has now adopted another policy is trying to identify political leaders and eminent personalities whom they want to assassinate through acts of terrorism and through terrorists. This is a very dangerous maneuver by Pakistan. The Indian security forces and the intelligence agencies are absolutely alert, and we are on the lookout for those whom Pakistan wishes to use for carrying out this threat.
As Kashmir is heading towards more peace and prosperity, Pakistan, being envious of this development, is busy hatching wily plots to incite terrorism in the valley. They are now targeting innocent civilians without any protection. Terrorists belonging to Jaish-e-Mohammed group attacked the wife and daughter of a police constable in South Kashmir this week. Such attacks have witnessed a spike in last few months. Last month, terrorists shot dead a special police officer along with his wife and daughter in Pulwama district at his home. These terrorist attacks are meant not only to cause large-scale damage to life and property, but also to create an atmosphere of fear and terror among the people of Jammu and Kashmir.
The air of deep uncertainty that has for so long dominated Afghanistan appear even larger as the country is witnessing constant clashes between Taliban insurgents and Afghan forces. The unsystematic withdrawal of US and NATO troops has only worked in the favor of the Taliban as they are making rapid territorial gains in Afghanistan. Meanwhile, Pakistan has been taking advantage of the current chaos and is openly supporting the Taliban to gain the stronghold and fight against the Afghan government. A report.
As the Afghan President Ashraf Ghani offered prayers on the Muslim festival of Eid al-Adha, at least three rockets landed near the Afghan presidential palace in Kabul, which is one of the most secure zones in the country. Reports suggest that Islamic State was behind the attack that clearly indicates the growing stronghold of terror groups in the war-torn nation amid Taliban's military offensive against Afghan government. However, Afghan president blamed Taliban for the attack and said that the Taliban have no intention and willingness for peace. With US ground forces in Afghanistan set to leave the country by the end of August, experts say the specter of international terrorism is making an unwelcome return. There are possibilities that other extremist groups, particularly ISIS and Al-Qaeda, could once again use Afghanistan as a base to launch attacks around the world.
I think it is alarming that the ISIS is also coming in. And I know one knows what will happen after some time, because remember, there has been a tendency in the Western media, aided and abetted by Pakistan, to normalize the role of the Taliban. First they talked about good Taliban and bad Taliban, now it appears that the entire Taliban is actually good. I fear the same will happen with ISIS. We will initially talk about good ISIS and bad ISIS, and after some time this entire ISIS ideology will be normalized and mainstreamed. I think that is something to be worried about. All this talk about the Taliban just walking into Kabul and taking over, I think is overestimating the Taliban's strength. Let us watch this space. So far, I think the Afghan government is putting up a very good fight.
The security situation in Afghanistan is becoming worse by the day as US troops continue with their withdrawal. The Taliban have gained ground in several key towns and border crossings and now claim to control over 80% of the country. Fears are mounting that it is only a matter of time before the Taliban hoist their flag in Kabul, the capital of Afghanistan. Meanwhile, Pakistan has taken advantage of the chaos and has openly supported the Taliban to gain the stronghold and fight against the Afghan government. Afghan President Ashraf Ghani says that Pakistan has not severed its relationship with terror groups. Last week, Ghani lashed out at Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan and the military for aiding the Taliban. He said that more than 10,000 jihadi fighters have entered Afghanistan in the last month, while the Pakistan government had failed to convince the Taliban to participate seriously in the peace talks.
Intelligence estimates indicate the influx of over 10,000 jihadi fighters from Pakistan and other places in the last month, as well as support from their affiliates in the transnational terrorist organization. There's a consensus among credible international observers that they've not taken any steps to sever their relationship with terrorist organizations. Contrary to the declarations of their political office that they will not attack cities and provincial centers, they are accelerating their attacks in attempting to starve the city. Contrary to the repeated assurances by Prime Minister Khan and his generals that Pakistan does not find a Taliban takeover in Afghanistan in Pakistan's interest, in short of use of force, will use its power to influence to make the Taliban negotiate seriously. Networks and organizations supporting the Taliban are openly celebrating the destruction of the assets and capabilities of the Afghan people and state.
Earlier this month, the ISI-backed Taliban took control of border crossings in Afghanistan, including Spin Boldak near Kandahar, which is a major port of entry between Afghanistan and Pakistan. Afghan army tried to regain the territory. However, Amrullah Saleh, the vice president of Afghanistan, alleged that the Pakistan Air Force stopped Afghan forces and provided close air support to the Taliban. Several videos and pictures of Taliban supporters roaming and waving flags in Pakistan's Quetta surfacing over social media clearly exposed Pakistan. Reports suggest that Quetta Shura, that is the Taliban's leadership council, still operates from Balochistan's capital, Quetta.
The Western world has chosen deliberately to turn a blind eye to whatever Pakistan is doing. I mean, where are the Taliban leaders? The big Taliban leaders are not to be seen in Afghanistan. They are either seen in Qatar or they are seen in Pakistan. So for Pakistan to say that they are not aiming, arming and aiding Taliban is so false, the rest of the world knows it but chooses to ignore it. Secondly, I think a far more alarming development was the following, that when the Taliban were really under pressure, getting pushed back, the Pakistan government sent a message to the Afghan government, as said by Vice President Amirullah Saleh, that if you keep on fighting like this, we will basically provide Taliban with air support. Now, that is, if that is not just blatant support, it is Pakistani involvement in the Afghan war.
Taliban have not even spared journalists covering the Afghan conflict. Taliban fighters killed an Indian journalist, Danish Siddiqui, on July 16, while covering a clash between Afghan security forces and Taliban insurgents near a border crossing with Pakistan. Although Taliban denied their role in his killing and even expressed regret over the death of Pulitzer Award-winning journalist, news reports suggest that Taliban not only shot Siddiqui, but also disrespected and mutilated his body. With the rise of Taliban insurgents in the war-wrecked country, the risk of such targeted killing of media persons has risen further.
Now let's talk about Pakistan, which remains on the grey list of the Financial Action Task Force after its failure to act against UN-designated terror groups operating from its soil. The United States has now told Pakistan to swiftly complete 27-point action plan on terror. The question arises, as will Pakistan ever take action against these terror groups, which it has been using for its proxy war against its neighbors? We have a report.
Pakistan remains a sanctuary for UN-designated terror groups. They include Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed, Al-Qaeda, the Haqqani Network, and the Taliban. Despite remaining on FATF's grey list, Pakistan has failed to act against these dreaded terrorists, and it continues to use them as proxies against neighboring Afghanistan and India. The United States has now urged Pakistan to continue working with FATF to swiftly complete its 27-point action plan by demonstrating that terrorism financing probes and prosecutions target terrorists and commanders of the UN-designated terror groups. At its virtual meeting in June, the Paris-based FATF retained Pakistan on its grey list for failing to check money laundering leading to terror financing. It asked Pakistan to investigate and prosecute Jaish-e-Mohammed chief Masood Azhar, Lashkar-e-Taiba founder Hafiz Saeed, and others.
We do recognize and we support Pakistan's continued efforts to satisfy those obligations. Pakistan has made significant progress on its first action plan, with 26 of 27 action items largely addressed. We encourage Pakistan to continue working with the FATF and the international community to swiftly complete the remaining action item by demonstrating that terrorism financing, investigations, and prosecutions target senior leaders and commanders of UN-designated groups.
Sheltering terror groups not only led Pakistan to face massive economic loss, but its citizens and visitors are paying a huge price due to homegrown terrorism. Blasts and terror attacks are common in the country, resulting in severe damage to human life. Recently, 9 Chinese and 4 Pakistanis were killed in a deadly attack on a bus carrying Chinese engineers to an under-construction tunnel site at the Dasu Hydropower Project in Kohistan district of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province. No terror group has yet claimed responsibility for the attack, but experts believe that Pakistan will pay a huge price by providing safe haven to dreaded terrorists on its soil.
The way Pakistan has treated its minorities, the way they have persecuted them, it's obvious that a large number of groups have emerged which are targeting not only Pakistan army, Pakistani establishment, and also the Pakistani nationals, as well as certain people like Chinese nationals who are coming there, whom they feel is inimical to the interest of Pakistan. Terror groups like TTP and terror groups, other terror groups, certainly are going to target the Chinese as well.
Despite serious consequences emerging with the rise of jihadi outfits, Pakistan continues to play a cat and mouse game with the international community on terror financing. Though Pakistan has put some restrictions on the public appearances of top leaders and commanders of terrorist groups, their operations remain intact. Experts believe that Pakistan takes one step forward to get relief from international pressure, and two steps back once the pressure is off, and again a step forward when the pressure resumes.
Violence always affects the life of innocent civilians, but it poses a massive threat to those from the minority community. A large number of Shia Muslims living in Afghanistan and Pakistan are worried about growing aggression after the withdrawal of US-led NATO forces. The Hazara Shia community, which has suffered discrimination, persecution and massacres because of their ethnicity, are apprehensive as the Taliban is gaining stronghold in Afghanistan. We have a report.
This is the aftermath of a car bombing in Kabul. On 8th of May, at least 50 people died and more than 100 wounded in 3 explosions targeting girls outside a school in the Dasht-e-Bachi area of West Kabul, an area populated largely by the Shia Hazara community. The attack was not the first time that the Hazaras had been targeted by extremist outfits in Afghanistan. They have often been targeted by extremist groups, whether it's the Taliban or Islamic State. For the country's minority Hazaras, such attacks are grim reminders of the persecution they endured under the rule of mainly ethnic Pashtun and Sunni Taliban, which viewed Shiites as apostates. Now, the members of Shia and Hazara community are raising concerns with regard to the recent developments in Afghanistan after the withdrawal of foreign troops from the war-torn country.
In Afghanistan, we believe there is a genocide going on against the Hazaras and the Shias. And because most of the attacks are directed against us in Western Kabul, as well as other areas of Afghanistan, but mostly in Western Kabul, where we have a large number of people concentrated there. Our schools, our hospitals, universities, courses, sports clubs, any gathering that they can find, they target. And the latest was about 2 months ago, where they targeted a girls' school, a high school. and more than 100 of our youngsters were dead.
Throughout the 20th century, successive Pashtun-led regimes in Afghanistan targeted the Hazaras, the country's third largest ethnic group, making up about 20% of the population. They were massacred and tortured. Uprisings were viciously crushed. Their religious leaders were jailed, women were abducted. Most Hazara languished in poverty and humiliation, forced to take menial jobs. Their persecution particularly began during the reign of Amir Abdul Rahman, who ruled from 1880 to 1901 and sold and bought people from the Hazara community as slaves.
The king or emir of those days, called Abdul Rahman Khan, he had to use religion in order to collect people to fight in Afghanistan. So he waged a holy war, so to speak, a jihad against the Shias. He took the fatwa of some of the Sunni religious leaders, and he declared jihad against the Shias, and all the people from both sides of the line, the Durand line, that later on became to be known, they went to Afghanistan, and they plundered central part of Afghanistan, much of what is nowadays Kandahar, in Zabul and other provinces were Hazara territory.
The situation in neighboring Pakistan is no different. This vulnerable minority group is facing threats from several extremist and terror outfits in Pakistan. According to Pakistan's National Commission of Human Rights, more than 2,000 Hazaras have been killed in Pakistan in the last 15 years. It is believed that Lashkar-e-Jangvi is responsible for most of these killings. Though Pakistan's ISI has termed Lashkar-e-Jangvi as one of the most virulent terrorist organizations, evidence still suggests that the state continues to support it. Most of the similar terror outfits are run by Sunni Muslim hardliners, and this is the reason why Pakistan government and the ISI try to avoid confrontation at all costs, and on many occasions they even support these groups.
Ye jo dehshatgardi hai, iske piche vardi hai, which means army is promoting terrorism. This has become the most common slogan in Pakistan among the Shias, as well as the Baloch, Sindhis, Pashtun, and people of Gilgit-Baltistan. This shows that people have a basic awareness and an understanding of the driving forces behind the large-scale killings of the civilians, especially the racial and religious minorities opposing Pakistan's strategic depth paradigm. In Pakistan, the relationship of military and the militants is supreme, and it comes at the cost of the security and well-being of people like Shias. This means that the law enforcers and the security personnel will not come to the rescue of Shias, Baloch, or the Hazaras when militants attack to displace or eliminate them.
Hazaras in Afghanistan have faced decades of abuse and state-sponsored discrimination, most recently under the Taliban regime between 1996 to 2001. The power vacuum that foreign forces leave behind in Afghanistan could claim the Hazaras among its first victims.
And with that, we come to the end of this episode of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@nin.com. This is Shreya Vijay signing off on the behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.